Ladies and gentlemen, very good evening to you all. Hiragangi and Associates LLP is elated to welcome you all to this webinar on enterprise risk management. Our speakers for today are CA Madhukar N. Hiragangi and CA Madhav R. and CA Sushil Kumar. CA Madhukar N. Hiragangi is a senior partner at Hiragangi and Associates LLP, having an office in Bangalore and 14 other locations across India. He has encouraged 130 plus leading professionals in the industry to take up ethical practice. He is active speaker and served as the chairman of the Indirect Tax Committee during the term 2016 to 2019. He has jointly authored 10 books in GST, which are available on leading commerce platforms. I welcome you, sir. CA Madhav R. is a partner at Hiragangi & Associates LLP and heads the audit team at Bangalore office. He is an active contributor of articles to various journals and is also prolific speaker on GST. He has co-authored a book on GST for Bangalore University's commerce students and practical guide to GST audits and certifications, and presently writing a book on GST for CA, IPCC and CMA students. I welcome you, sir. Sushil Kumar is a chartered accountant with 11 years of experience in internal audit, cost control, process re-engineering and automation in reputed organizations. He heads the Value Added Audit Division in H&A. He is also certified Forensic Auditor Diploma in IFRS from ACCA UK, certified Six Sigma Executive Black Belt, and postgraduated in Artificial Intelligence and Machine Learning. I welcome you, sir.
Thank you.
Now I request the speaker to begin the address.
Very good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Nice of you to join us for this building resilience sharing. This is a very elaborate subject, which in normal course could be a day's program or even more than that. However, we would provide you a glimpse of it, and Sushil probably will go to the nitty-gritties. I would just give a small overview. Sushil, this overview is basically based on the fact that things have not done well. COVID actually put a huge brake on the economies of the world, and it put possibly a bigger brake on India, where we do not have the, what you can say, resources saved up for most of our population. The poor are unable to, you know, feed themselves, and there is certainly a large amount of, what I could say, huge amount of suffering which happened. Businesses also are not left alone. And I think only those people who had the salaried class in government and maybe in some of the larger enterprises, they were not impacted at all. Everybody else had an impact. Even smaller concerns had a cutback, and therefore there was much of production losses, profit losses, the top line disappeared, and the growth certainly was negative in most of the industries except a couple, like the IT industry, which did well in this period. So it was an unprecedented disaster, I would say. Can you just open up the whole slide? So this, we may not be able to get back into the old normal at all. That is what was there before the pandemic came. What is it that has happened now in this period? The consumer has totally changed. Now I see in our own houses that we probably buy 95% of whatever we need is coming through the Amazon or the Flipkarts, Swiggy's. The spending also, obviously, because of the change in the way of earning, the persons who can spend also have changed. And the younger people, I think, are being advantaged in today's world. We are also finding a lot of disruptions happening. And technology is playing a very, very big role. I think this is something which is very good for India, because we have the entrepreneurial thought process, and now even people without, you know, funds can only with an idea can get into a $1 billion valuation. You have seen Baiju's, Swiggy, Zomato, so many of them. These startups are also coming up and looking at where they can do something, and certainly the old ways of doing business are getting disrupted. The competitors also are not those expected. Suddenly you may have a competitor out of nowhere, some other country, for something you have been doing in your locality or state or country. With this, I would like to hand over back to I think Mahadev will speak next, and then we can go ahead. I would like to wish you all a very good learning, and I'm sure you'll have a lot of questions which you can get back to Sushil. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Mahadev?
Yeah, you can put up the entire slide, Sushil. Good afternoon, everybody. So in this slide, we will understand some of the important lessons which we have learned during this COVID period. So after that, we have our main batsman, Virat Kohli, who is going to take you through the entire session. The first important lesson is that even a single risk can affect the entire organization. So we know how a single risk of this COVID has impacted the entire world. In fact, we know that there is no organization or there is no business which is not impacted through this COVID. So we can't ignore any risk now. So that is one big learning which we have got through this COVID situation. Next is, even if there is a remote risk, it can become a reality. So when the COVID was detected, I think somewhere in end of 2019, when in China, so nowhere in the other parts of the world, we realize that this is going to be a reality in our own country, and it is going to impact our country, our house, or in fact, our income also in this way. So we can't ignore any of the risks. So any remote risk can become a reality wherein the ERM is going to play a very major role. And of course, the next major learning should be that if you are patient, so we will have a good future for sure. So in the past also, we have come across the situation. Maybe my generation wouldn't have seen this scenario, but I'm sure that if there's an older generation, or if we go through the history books, so there are a similar situation like this. Even in 1920 also, we had a situation like this. Then World War also had impacted the entire economy of the world. So I think being patient is going to teach us a lot of things. And good things are going to come for sure in future. So even sir also touched upon that the business is not going to be done in the same way in which it was being done in the pre-COVID situation. The business model is going to change, and even the customer's expectation is also going to change. So now I would not like to wait in the restaurant to get the food served. So within a click of 2-3 buttons, I would expect the food come to my table at my home, wherein I can watch my IPL match and I can have food. So that is the expectation which is there now, which in a way it is dangerous also, because we don't know what is going to happen to our patient's level with this. And next is, we also have read and understood or heard that there are many businesses which have excelled also by taking an opportunity from this risk. So if one is interested, so you can study how Amul took advantage of the situation, COVID situation. In fact, they introduced, I think, 10 to 15 new products to leverage their business. And they reported, I think, 5 or 6% growth in this COVID period. So that is the way they could manage it. Again, it was a larger organization, but the thing is that they had a better processes which helped them, and they also could take an immediate decision and implement by seeing the opportunities in this. So that is one important learning which was there from this COVID. Aligning this ERM is going to be very, very important with all the strategic positions, whether it could be the top management or anybody in the lower position. So ERM should involve all the important functions at the organization level so that it can be very effectively implemented and we can prepare well for any of these types of situation in future for sure. Now I would like to hand over this session to Sushil. Sushil.
Thank you, Madhav. Good afternoon, everyone. So thank you for being here, and we'll have like probably another 40 minutes to, you know, to discuss on. So I'll run a video. So I would request all of you to watch it and, you know, keep your views on it. So we'll discuss that eventually when we go across the other slides. So from the video, there are a few thoughts, like it can be interpreted in many ways. So just to align it to the program. So one is when things were normal, people, I mean, the model of working is different. When things have changed, we cannot expect the same model to work. That is one. And second, the person who asked to speed up should have really understood what is happening, and the people who are working also should communicate what really is happening. The two-way communication was also lacking. So that caused a risk of putting the candidates down somewhere or spoiling them, not wrapping them properly, right? So that is what we say here. When the change accelerates, so does the need to realign. So this is one of the classic cases. Many of us can recollect by seeing this, the reel. There was a company who has ruled the market in the business of the camera rules, the camera, for more than a century, but then they had to file bankruptcy in the year 2012 eventually. So it is not that they were not innovative enough or they were not creative enough, But the thing is, the model that they have already put in place, and they were so much obsessed with the model and the revenue they were gaining from one particular major source of business, that they found it very difficult to get detached from that and get onto some other business, even though they were the ones who have developed the other set of business. Okay, so this has led them to a disaster, because one is knowing that things would threaten them, they have delayed it. One, and second is, they did not wish to change the model well in advance. They acted it very late. So we are talking about Kodak. So this is about the history of Kodak. In the year 1960 or so, 62 or so, it has crossed $1 billion revenue. And it also got an award for best innovation, on the innovation from US. Okay. And the point that they failed is because, they have in fact like developed a digital photography, but one of the statement that came out was, yes, we got the award and we have developed the digital photography, but do not speak to anyone. So that is how the management reacted, because the camera films were giving them a good amount of revenue, like Gillette was earning more revenue from the blades than the razor. Right. So here, and another thing is, they were so much aligned to their value chain model, and they were having complete say on it. But when it came to the digital, they have to partner with many the organizations which they were not able to do it, or they were not comfortable enough. Okay, so what was the result? And they were one of the best companies in S&P 500. And now if we look at the blue ones are the films, film roll, and the red ones are the digital photography. So after 2000, we see that the growth of, the decline of the film roll was, very rapid, and they, by 2005, almost they were nothing. In 2010, S&P removed them from the top 500. And in the year 2012, they filed a bankruptcy. And the detail of which we have it in our detail slide, which we would be sharing the whole of the case study. It's an interesting one to understand, even though we are leader in certain places, but that does not last forever unless we align ourselves to the new needs. So, those are some of the risky aspects or the risk aspect we saw. So having seen them, we'll just try to connect back to what a risk is. So here, there are a lot of definitions and statements around it, but to keep it very simple, risk is nothing but it is a possibility of an event occurring which would have an impact of achieving a business objective. So there are three things. One is possibility of an event happening, and it has an impact. Okay, could be positive or negative. And third one is which would have an impact on the achievement of the objective. So the objective of the business is also to be known, right? So the risk can be perceived as three. One is the opportunity that is lost. The risk also comes with, risk is like a coin. It always comes with some sort of opportunity which is there on the other side, which we need to see through. So let's say like during this COVID, a lot of people saw the opportunity of digitization. They made it and they capitalized on it, right? And the other thing is the uncertainty, which is the variability. Like let's say like we are expecting and that we have a target, and there could be positive or negative variances, right? So that sort of uncertainty is also there when we do a business. So that also can be a risk if it exceeds beyond a tolerance level. And there are threats and hazards which could arise from the natural disaster or this pandemic, or even a fraud which is done internally of the case it is done by the internal stakeholder. So the key terms before we get into the ERM the topic are the factors, which the factors here we call like these are the drivers which would amplify either the likelihood of the event happening, which is not desired, or the impact. The factor could be internal or external. So what are the internal factors? There could be like the policies, the reporting guideline, the reporting structure, or it could be the whole of the risk management organization itself, or what are the technologies and tools that are used to look into those risk parameters. And the external risk factor could be of any of this, like political risk, or there are a lot of risks. Like it comes from many aspects, like probably six aspects we can call, like we have it in the subsequent slides, like political, economic, environment, and social. It could be also like from our own operating, from our external stakeholder also it can come from. even from the regulatory changes that also come from, I mean, that they, those also need to be considered when we look into the risks. And it is not that everything we can look at and everything we would look to manage. So we have to have a risk capacity defined at an organization level, and risk appetite also defined both at organization level as well at a I mean functional level, which are completely different, or BU level, business unit level. So the risk categories could be like, these are the categories like strategic, financial, operational, reputational, hazard, which is now gaining the momentum, and it's a talk in the town now, environment, health and safety, and legal and regulatory. And then we need to also understand what is an inherent risk and residual risk. Inherent risks are nothing but the raw risk or the crude form of risk. Before we take any control around it, whatever we see as a risk, those are the inherent risks. And the residual is after we apply the treatment plans or controls around it, whatever is left over, that is residual risk, which also need to be considered whether it is falling below my risk appetite so that I can accept it for the time being, or I should apply any mitigation plan. So residual risk and business risk and operational risk. Business risks are those which can prove a decision wrong, and operational risks are those risks which are which might arise while executing the decision that is taken. And emerging risks are the risks which we have to foresee and prepare ourselves accordingly. The ones which we are seeing which might emerge very soon are the climate change, which will have impact on the energy sectors, immediate impact, and then the sectors which are dependent on those sectors, the immediate effect, and of course the digitization also. And can we eliminate the risk completely? I mean, that also we'll just see the video and just get some sort of insight, and then we go on to the other topics.
Found a way to eliminate risk entirely from our projects. Light Crystal, custom engineer. Name a project we're bidding.
McChesney Office Complex.
In February, we'll have a crane accident. It shuts us down for 8 days.
Cooper Smith.
We've got cost overruns in March from a global spike in steel prices. In April, credit markets freeze up. We'll have two subcontractors going under.
Was this expensive?
A little.
Gonna be rich. Did we have insurance on that?
So we saw that, okay, even if we get, I mean, any number of tools or technologies to, you know, manage risk and all, unless we also calibrate them and monitor them on a regular basis, the risk cannot be managed. And definitely risk cannot be eliminated. It can only be managed. So what is a risk management? So we need to have an objective. Okay, only when we know the objective, we would know what would stop us from reaching there. Then we can apply the risk management. Okay, so why risk management? Of course, to achieve the business objective. And second is, to also comply with the regulatory norms, which are there as per Schedule 4 to the financial statement, SEBI, and the Companies Act. So, which we do otherwise, IFC or in the form of ICFR. Okay. And also, the risk management helps us to capitalize certain opportunities which otherwise we would not be able to do so. So, seizing an opportunity, we have the cases here, like cases. One is like the commercial airlines, they started offering the cargo flights because they could sense that, you know, there would be lockdown, there is a border restriction and all of it. Similarly, these are the following other things wherein people could see an opportunity and turn their business model accordingly. Alibaba is a classic case which has proved it twice. One is during the SARS, during 2002 to 2004. Ideally, it was into the B2B market. Now it has also become the B2C during the SARS. And they have introduced a new concept called staff leasing. They had a discussion with the hospitality industry, which were in the verge of laying off the staff. They leased the staff and utilized them to meet the increasing demand in home delivery. Okay. So even we talk about EV now, so electric vehicles, we talk like, okay, now, yes, fair enough, this is a cost effective, but how do we manage the charging if we run out of the charge? It would take a lot of time. But then there are companies in South Korea, they have developed even the battery swap stations, wherein the batteries can be taken out from the vehicle, put into the station, and the fresh two batteries can be taken, which are already charged. So these are the opportunities people are looking around, even when there are risks. So ERM would definitely help us in achieving those. So ERM, what is ERM? So this is a very theoretical definition given by COSO. But there are key words which we would look at. One is, it is a process. It's not a one-time event. It has to be done continuously, one. And second is, it is affected by the board of directors. So it comes from the top. And it involves everyone. And it involves every process. And it is even applied in the strategy setting. It is when we say it is strategy setting, we have to have a risk appetite. What a company is, risk appetite is. So accordingly, the company strategy should be aligned to. And this would help us when we do all of this, it would definitely help us in reaching our business objective to a greater extent. So ERM making a difference. So what are the three key things that ERM makes? One is reduction of the major surprises, the one we had now, like COVID. There are companies who had the process clearly laid out and all, like when such type of business continuity, there is a harm on the business continuity emerges, how is that it can be reacted? So we had the BCPs which lasted for a week or couple, but this time it has lasted for years or a couple of years. So that was the difference, but they had setting things ready in place so that did not take much time for them to react quickly, at least to some extent. Then reduction in the mistakes which happens during the regular operation, and definitely it would help us in enabling the strategic decision making. May it be a kind of like how do we realign our business model to should we get into a new business or not. To that extent also it would help. So these are the explanation to that. And COSO has a new framework, and this is the ERM framework, which earlier used to be more on the operation. Now it is also saying that the ERM has to be embedded even at the strategic level and across the organization. And it also talks about leveraging the technology, which we would be discussing in the subsequent slide. And here, how do we say that we would do the ERM successfully? So it is when we say it is a process, but a process also needs some sort of pillars. There are some infrastructure that should be around. There should be support from the top management. When we say the support, it should be through the policy, and it should be through the risk rating guidelines, which are needed to define how risky a particular event is. And what are the methodology to identify the risk and manage the risk? And what technology and what sort of data we are looking at, and how the data, how accurate the data are, and how often the data flows to the system for the ERM to say that, okay, now this is what the risk rating of a particular event is. And then the organization, it should be across the organization, and the reporting structure also should be predefined. So this calls for a complete support from the top management. And also it has to be integrated to the strategic objective setting, and it has to be aligned to the business performances and to the operational performance also. And it has to be defined, the risk appetite of the organization or the business unit should also be defined so that every decision is aligned to those risk appetite. And the processes are, we are talking about the risk. First is the objective, because unless we know the objective, we won't know like what is hampering it and how risky it is. So one is establish the context, then identify the risk, assess the risk, and not all the risks can be addressed. So we need to prioritize the risk and developing the risk treatment plan and implementing them, testing and monitoring that the whatever is implemented is operating effectively, and the design that has been put in place is also not outdated and they are of relevance today also, and integrating the result to at every level. So this is the same thing with some examples. And when we say identify the risk, we need to identify a couple of things here. One is, when we say a risk, okay, again, the definition is a threat exploiting a vulnerability. Okay, so we need to identify what is the threat. What is the vulnerability is a weak link in my process. So the threat could be internal or external, which we discussed, and what the vulnerability. So those things has to be listed down. And okay, things can go wrong, but is it within the I mean, within my risk appetite. If yes, risk appetite should also be defined, because unless we define the risk appetite, how do we say that, okay, what should I do with this? If something is much below my risk appetite, probably I can ignore that as well. I can accept and live with it. And then we have to distinguish between internal external event and the risks with opportunities, because the treatments are different here, and the way it is dealt with and the levels at which it is dealt with are different. So before we get on to even identifying the risk, we need to understand what sort of ecosystem the business is run in. So we need to understand the regulators there, the impact from the regulators, the legal system around the business, the suppliers, the customers, the investors, and the financial institutions. One. And also, unless we know the speed at which things are changing, it would be difficult for us to give an importance to this subject. Because if you look at the example S&P 500, some time ago it took 67 years for a company to be in the S&P, then it became 15 years. Now it is expected that if a company lasts 5 years in the S&P, it would be a big thing. Because the way this ecosystem is changing, it is unprecedented, and it is very, monumental changes. And understanding the business model, so we need to understand the detailed business model, then only we would be able to analyze and assess where what sort of risk could emerge. So this is an example for an automobile industry. So how do we identify? We have a couple of models here. One is the SWOT model, so which would help us to identify. And then there is a PESTEL, which talks about different factors, the six factors. And then there is something called Porter's five force model, which talks about what threat from different sides it can come in. Okay. And the dimensions to the risk identification, not every risk that we identify we can look at, because considering the cost and benefit and the time and the severity, not everything can be done at a time, right? So we need to prioritize them. So for that, we need to accept the risk from various sources and classify them, what impacts the business, what impacts the operation, and what is the impact on the financial statement also. And need to identify what sort of likelihood it has, what is the probability that it might occur, and what impact would have if it is triggered. And then define the what are the top business risks. And it is not one-time activity, it has to be done, because some time ago we thought, okay, data security, because we are having a data in our local premises, and we have the data security in place, and I don't have a business spread across, even if it is a scale. But now there is an opportunity that unless we are digitized, we won't be able to reach the customer, the penetration and all of it would be tough. So in this context, we need to have a stronger data security, because customers use the credit card and their banking information. If that gets leaked, it would be a disaster. So that is where the risk keeps changing with the situations changing. So we need to define also a risk. So it is a risk statement. This is how it is defined. We need to have an event which gets triggered, and what is the root cause of it, and then the impact it would cause on the objective. So the bare minimum, these three should be there while we write a risk statement. So one of the example is in a bidding in a construction company. In a construction company, like a person who is responsible to finalize the quote and participate in the bid. Was a very dynamic and a very intelligent person. He did it. He got a lot of success. But recently, until this exercise took place, there are few cases they lost the bid. So that's where the management got worried and tried to understand what exactly the root cause is. When they saw it, it is because of the uncompetitiveness of the bid, one. And why it is uncompetitiveness? It is not the person's competency. It is then the assumptions were wrong. While preparing the bid, the quote, while arriving at the quote, the assumptions were wrong. And why the assumptions were wrong? Because the same person was dealing with both preparation of the quote, and he was given some sort of responsibility to go to the project sites and capture certain data and report to the management. Then there's like, okay, so what, how much time do you focus? Then it is identified that the person goes in the morning, comes back at probably 6 or 7 in the evening. And then he starts sitting and starts working on this sort of aspects. Then the point is, the same person, if is given too important responsibility, the focus may not be, the desired focus may not be given to the respective jobs. And hence, the management decided to stop him well and take out certain work from him and give it to the person who reports to him. So see, this is a very basic example, but it can cause as big as losing out the whole of the tender itself, Okay, so we should not ignore some risks, considering this is the small or big. It has an impact. There are interdependencies of the risks. Those things need to be looked at. And the few are the below other examples, which can come from the supply chain. It can come from the political or economical instability, which we can see from the Afghanistan. India has put a lot of money in the EPC projects in Afghanistan. Now, after this Taliban taking over it, there are a lot of uncertainty around it. So in the switching to the green energy from the traditional way of the thermal or the hydro. And there was another thing due to regulatory, Mahindra and Mahindra also had to come out of the US market. So these are certain examples, which we have detailed in our other slides also, which we will be sharing after the session. And after identifying, we need to assess, because not all the risks can be addressed. So we have to identify what are the likelihood and what are the impacts and what tolerance the company has. At that particular level of which we are talking, probably a BU level or probably for a particular function itself, let's say like debt equity ratio, mine normal is the standard is 2:1, but the management is ready to take it up to like 2.75 or 3. So it is fine. So that the tolerance has to be defined by the management so that things can be considered like which is risky or which is not risky. Okay. And also the interrelation of the various types of risks should also be looked at, and how do we measure it. So we need to have a scale around it. So we define a risk scale, which is a combination of both the likelihood and the impact. So from there, we can arrive at like whether it's like the chances of them are like, we can see like this here, we can see the likelihood and the impact. So rare and insignificant, it is one. Here it is nothing but the multiplication. Okay. So when it's catastrophic, it almost certain, this is something we need to focus first, all the reds first, and then the second and the third. That's how the high, medium, and low can be focused upon. And this is some illustrative. This is not the standard ones. And it would vary from organization to organization and the business model to business model and the risk appetite. And the treatment, before treating, we need to understand certain things. Like, of course, the risk appetite. We are repeating risk appetite because unless that is defined, nothing can be done. So risk appetite has to be defined. And then the root cause has to be identified. And what are the existing controls that is surrounding that particular event getting triggered? And what are the the measures that are taken after the event gets triggered? So those things, after a review of those, then we can arrive and like what sort of control, further control requirements are all. Then we can look at the treatment. We call that like ATMA Atma. It could be either avoided. Let's say like certain tire companies in India do not venture into the airplane tire, even though the margin is huge. Except MRF, I don't think anyone else is doing it. So because even though the margin is high, but if there are any tire bursts happening, the impact is something which cannot be bearable. So a lot of companies, let's say like Michelin, has avoided doing this. Okay, and transferring the risk. I know a company like there was a fire accident. Okay, and the plant and machinery and the facility got burned. So those things were insured. And also it took time for them to restore back the facilities for the production to start. So during such time, they lost the profit. So they have taken the insurance on the loss of profit also. So here the risk, the truck plant, the treatment plan is transferred to the insurance company. So, and then the mitigate. So mitigate here is like we take action to ensure that the risk does not trigger or the likelihood gets reduced. Even if it happens, the impact is not much. We take quick action. And accept it is well within my risk appetite, and hence I accept it. But the acceptance, once it is not for all, always. So every time we need to look at with the risk, those sort of risks, are they still below my risk appetite or have they gone beyond? Because the risk clusters, when we visualize, it keeps changing, it keeps moving. It doesn't remain the same throughout. And the treatment implementation, we need to evaluate all proposals, develop treatment plan, execute the plan. And then once it is executed, it is not done, we need to monitor whether it is operating effectively or not. And does it have any relevance even in today's context? A lot of things have got outdated considering the revised business models the companies have adopted after this COVID. So now today, no one talks like I need salary on the first day or 30th day, or that is not the target, that it has to be processed in 24 hours. Now people are not talking like, the invoice booking or processing, it has to happen 3-4 days. If not, we can go for the prepayment and we can come back on the reconciliation. So the focus is more on the payment to the vendor so that my supply does not get interrupted. Not that how and where it is reviewed and how long did it take. So these are some operational examples I'm giving, but even at the strategic level, things have changed. And the risk response need not to be on an individual level. It is always better that we make a portfolio of risks, and the risks of similar type are given as a treatment plan. It could be one or it could be multiple. So, and there are a few other facts about how do we treat the risk. An example here, we have a live case study. So wherein there was a company which is into shipping, the container shipping. So though the major line of profit could be, let's say, like basic ocean freight and terminal handling charges. Okay, and third could be the others, miscellaneous. So the focus was more on these two lines and the neglect was on the third line. And over a period of time, it was seen that the margin per container got eroded or reduced in certain areas of geography. Okay, then this started concerning the management after it started exceeding the risk appetite. Then what happened is they started understanding what is the current level of evaluation. The evaluation is, okay, these are the two parameters we look at per container. Then, okay, now we have to look at like why things are going wrong. Then they started looking at the miscellaneous category. Then one of the category was the transportation. So in the transportation, there was no tying up of the cost and revenue. And even the blacklisted vendors started coming up back to the business through another name or another company floated by the same set of people. So that was neglected. So then after the response, I mean, these are the responses came. And other thing is like there are special service requests to the customers. And that was not billed properly, or a lot of waivers that were given at the respective places. These are some of factors that was also considered. So, but the primary thing which has to be given importance was on the transportation. Then the detention demurrage, the waivers. Then third one was the special service request. So it was given the risk priority, and the decision was taken. How do we deal with it? And then there was a system that was put in place. Wherein it was taking the data from the operating system and started giving the container-wise reconciliation with profit and both revenue and the cost. Hence, the profit was also ensured. So this was a classic case, and it was also monitored. The whole system is also getting monitored because even the system once developed doesn't hold good throughout. A lot of changes happen. We need to update the system also. So this examples also we saw like avoid and transfer, and this is the shipping container example was for the risk mitigation or the management. And then we have the last leg, which is the monitoring and reporting. So how do we monitor? There has to be some early warning indicators, which is a rule-based trigger. Both it could be quantitative and qualitative. So multiple source of information it captures, and also it has an early indication. These are the features of the early warning indicators. And another thing is the signal strength. I mean, let's say like the indicator is every time I receive an invoice, let's say it should be the average of a particular vendor's invoice is 1 lakh. But if it goes like 2-3% or 1% up and down, it is fine. But if I start receiving it at 250, 230, then it should trigger why it is going wrong. This is again an operational example. There are examples at the strategy level also. So those sort of things can be looked at. And this is the reporting structure. It should come from the top. The tone should be set at the top. The board should review things. And there are decision makers, the C-suite, the CXOs, and the custodians also should be given the target of their performance. Also should be appraised based on risk management should also be part of their KRA. And the risk champion should be nominated, identified and nominated to manage the job at the ground level because they are the SMEs. So how this has to be reported, this is an illustrative one again. In every board meeting, this would also be a topic, and a lot of companies are doing it. And every quarter, it has to be discussed by the CXOs before it goes to the board. And the process owners should discuss on every monthly basis with the risk champion, making things ready even on the monthly basis. Okay, these are the reports, and these are the life cycle. So one is the culture that has to be set. So if the culture is not set, the tone from the top is itself is not right, and if it is a mere of a compliance or lip service job, then it definitely would not yield any result. Then objective setting should be there, because unless we know the objective, we would not know what would hamper the objective. And then identify and prioritize the risk, evaluate the options, then confirm on the next step, that is the decision and implementation, and then evaluate the performance on a regular basis. And capability and maturity to identify where exactly we stand. So we have developed, there are five phases a company can go through their ERM journey. So one is the maturity level. With the more mature the organization becomes, the more value addition it derives from the ERM. One is the first step is like, have you identified all of the risks in the organization, both operational and strategic? And have we prioritized all the risks? That is one. If we have done this, we have already started our journey. And second is like, how is that we manage now? So after identification, how proactively are we managing? How proactively things are getting monitored? And how is that it is quantified? It is more of a mere an intuition, or there are some scientific ways to do things? Because intuition should change, because things should change, and before we realize it becomes late, that we cannot continue the same sort of intuition. But though it would help us in certain times, but it has to be more scientific. And then the next level is like, every time we take a decision, whether it's a strategic or operational, do we consider the risks that might arise out of such decisions? So that if we consider, we have arrived at already third level. And the fourth is, it is not that we take a decision and consider the risk. It is, before taking the decision, we should consider whether are we well within the risk appetite for us to take the decision. Okay. And do we act? And the last level is it, to making it the culture, putting it across the organization, both top down and bottom up. And this comes from the every person, how they behave while they execute any work. So this is how a capability and maturity is measured. This is one of the models. There are many models. So we can assess ourselves where exactly we stand today. And managing certain risks during COVID-19. So we have identified some five principles. One is people first, people focus, because a lot of, our business depend on the people and the decision and their role in the respective the functions. Right. And the second is to identify what is strategically important to a business, to identify that, because not everything can be done at the same time. So we need to prioritize it again. And second is identifying the risk attached or associated with those significantly important things. And then how do we respond to them, and then continuously monitor, because the economy outside is so dynamic and volatile. Things are changing. And what we thought as a remote has become a reality. And similarly, what we thought is our fifth priority in terms of the product manufacturing or the service rendering now has become like second or third, or even our internal services. And there are six steps how do we achieve it, so which we have discussed in this one by one here. One is identifying the things. The industry, of course, has got into the change mode, and how effectively have our business also got into that change mode. So that is one. And what is our new CSF, like critical success factor, has to be identified. Sometime ago, security probably not a primary focus for all the organizations. Accessibility also, we were satisfied with the current state of accessibility. Now this has become more important thing. Because people are not coming out, we need to reach out to the people, the customers, not only the people, the customers, or anyone for that matter, and the technology. Because these three are again illustrative. It would vary from business to business, because ERM is not a standard format for all. It is custom to every business. So, and second is assessing the new external environment. So this is an example again. So we have to assess like what would be our targeted revenue, the targeted cost, what is the share, and how much the business is dependent on the external stakeholders. And how is that we assess the stakeholder here? We assess on the three counts. These are the bare minimum three counts. One is the financial health, operational soundness, and the criticality. Here an example. In one of the telephone tower or the electric tower manufacturing company, while getting into the project, there was the risk assessment happens. Okay, so all there are the larger parts are for the tower, whatever is required, the major parts are considered to be of key risk. But there are smaller parts, and all of it they were not given that much of importance. But the point is, when it was all sent to the location, or when it was prepared to send to the location, to be sent to the location, it was realized that we do not have a particular item. When that is not there, the whole structure cannot be erected or cannot be fitted. Then the point is, then the value, why was it ignored? When it was analyzed, it was ignored. The value of it was very small. and it was accidentally also ignored. That could also be another reason. And this, the value was less than 5%. This less than 5% have halted the billing of the entire 95%, the remaining 95% work done. And it is not again off the shelf, it is a custom made, and it had to wait for a month's time before it could get installed. Okay, the towers. So this is the fist plate I'm talking about, for which are needed to join the towers, the structures. Okay, so evaluating the needed changes. So the changes also need to be evaluated on a regular basis. My older support system may not hold good to the newer the business model. So we have to have at least some basic scenarios available in front of us. What was my pre-COVID? What is the post-COVID? And in that, there are three scenarios. And that scenarios, for each scenario, we need to stress test that how robust are the supporting systems are. And if it is not, we need to build the capabilities around it. And there are a few examples here. One is like a fleet management company. It was more onto like owning the asset and then leasing out. Then they got into an agreement that this would not help now, because this adds on to the fixed cost, whereas they plan to improve on the variability cost. So they got into the agreement with the vehicle manufacturing company, that is on the repurchase agreement. So the whole thing is explained. So once this is done, so the repurchase agreement is taken, this become more of a variable cost. I am taking the vehicle on the need basis than owning a vehicle, a fleet itself. So this has freed a lot of fund from the business, which could be utilized for some other purpose. Okay, similarly, like companies are exiting from the non-core and getting into investing the fund into the needed, probably the technology. Other examples are like L&T has done it, and Cedant Corporation has also done it. And sale and leaseback agreement, like this is nothing but New York Times. They've also got into this. Their facility and premises, they have sold it, and they have taken it on lease based on the need. And that has helped them to pay off the debt. And they also changed the model to, they invested the money to change of the model from being a manual, the printed media, to more of a digital paid subscription model. So upside of the risk, the next is, as we just said, discussed at the beginning, that opportunities are there in the risk. That is all we need to identify. What is that we can leverage? So DMart was one of the classic example. So they, instead of where people could not go to them, because they saw like, okay, only certain set of people. See, what DMart is basically for the mid or the low class people. Okay, so people were going there, and now people could not go there. Then they came up with the thought like, okay, their customer base was only the low and middle. Now if I go to the door or the societies and make that as a kind of, make them the products available, now all the classes of people are available to me, and I can widen the customer base also. They have got into this model. Similarly, Apoteket is like one of the Sweden's largest pharmaceutical retailer, got into the agreement with the TCS to get into this digitization, digitizing their whole of the business. Similarly, MCX, this is multi-commodity exchange, our Indian multi-commodity exchange also got into TCS, had an agreement with the TCS to get into the digitized mode. And the simple example here we can talk about is the travel spend got reduced. Probably those money could be repurposed for the technical spend. So these are the opportunity that comes in. We need to identify, and we need to see like how we can utilize those opportunities. And it is always better that when we quantify and when we call a risk, we should not be like on an intuition based, or it should not be always qualitative. The more quantitatively we can define that, the better it is to evaluate what to be addressed first and what can be done in the next. This is one of, there are a lot of models like EMV, expected money value, decision tree, FMEA, Monte Carlo simulation. This is one of the example on the EMV given here. So this would also help us in establishing the matrices. So there is something called KRI. We said like this whole, it should be embedded to the respective function and every person's KRA also, key responsibility areas. This KRI are nothing but key risk indicators. So these are the illustrations we have given, even as simple as like unreconciled balance in accounts. So we can say like, okay, what could be the amount that could stay unreconciled, or how many customers can stay unreconciled, or how many accounts can stay unreconciled. So anything goes beyond that, probably focus needs to be given, because it's nothing wrong with that. The account, probably there is something wrong with the process itself. So similarly, like across it is there, and this is more of operational, it is given, and the right side it is on the strategy level, and which can impact the business also. We have given some examples. And what is next? One is like, first is we need to assess like what are the various scenarios we can foresee, and those scenarios also should be evaluated on a regular basis. and assess our existing process and infrastructure, how far it supports the ERM, the whole of the ERM implementation framework. And also, like wherever possible, we need to expand our repository of the scenarios and evaluate our own internal model on a regular basis, because the risks change, the importance change, the impact change, the likelihood change, then appetite also changes continuously. It is not unlike some time ago where things were reviewed like once in a quarter or 6 months. This is something which needs to be done on a regular basis. And what is the next after this COVID? It is not only the COVID. We are not talking your ERM or enterprise risk management only to manage the COVID. And there are a lot of changes that are happening now outside, and that would definitely impact our business. It is not long before they become a reality. So climate change is one of them. So that would have an impact. The larger companies started already, strategizing their business models in line with this. Let's say Reliance started talking about hydrogen power. Adani is talking about green energy, solar panel and all of it. There are companies which started talking about the wind energy and they started focusing. And there are a lot of non-traditional competitors. They are also coming into the play. So, I mean, they equip themselves. Unless we pick up or unless we catch up the speed, both in terms of aligning our thought model and technology, it would be difficult for us to be the market leaders, which all of us aim for. And this is our approach, how we deal with. One is we understand things before we start start talking, because every business is different. Every nitty-gritty is different. Even though industry is same, the way we conduct the business is different. It cannot also be generalized. This is same across the same similar companies under the industry. It can vary. And then after understanding, we do assess the current level. Then we plan, analyze, perform the whole of ERM implementation, and we report and then monitor also. So this is the last statement. The companies need to set the risk tolerance. We are talking the appetite again and again. Unless we talk about the appetite, everything is dependent on this. If we are not talking about the appetite and we are not reevaluating our risk appetite, it would be tough to achieve the new scale, new economies of the scale. And one thing is for sure, digitization, we would embed ourselves into the digitization world, but it is better that the sooner we adopt, the better it is, because by 2026, at least 26% of world's GDP is expected from the internet-based and the digitally connected industry, which we have seen also very recently during the COVID last 2 years. There is a 70% increase in the internet consumer and the people, the organizations or the individuals who started availing the cloud-based services. Okay, so this is all about from our side. So now we are open for the questions.
Does anybody have any queries?
You can ask here, or you can always write it back to us also. It would be better if we interact also in person. So we leave it to you, the options. You can always ask questions if there are any.
If anybody has any queries, you can raise your hand and I can unmute you.
Anushree, have you recorded the session?
Yes, sir.
Because there are many who registered but did not attend, so they are requesting for a recording of this video.
Yes, sir.
Maybe we need to share this link with the PPT.
Yes, sir.
There is a detailed PPT which has around 100 slides or so, which has a detailed explanation also for most of these points. So I request all the participants to go through it. And if required, you can share with respective teams also within your organization. And as Sushil said, please feel free to revert to Sushil on any of the doubts which you have in this regard. So we are planning to have similar sessions every month now. Maybe if any of you have any suggestions on the topics which you would like to which you would want us to cover, so that we can also
cover.
So please feel free to suggest on that aspect as well.
And as we discussed, this is basic. This is in fact a very basic discussion on the ERM. And as Madhukar sir also said at the beginning, it is a subject which can be discussed for days together. And yes. If you wish us to talk more specific to your business or the way it is run, we are always open. You can reach out to us so that we can understand your business, and it could be more of a kind of training or speaking at your premises, which would help you effectively manage things and how do you wish to implement things. And it is not an overnight journey, it takes time, but sooner we start, the better it is.
Okay, seems like there are no questions. We can conclude the session, Sushil.
Okay, thank you very much for your time. We hope to see you in our next seminar as well. We would expect you to interact more so that we understand your pain points, so that we also prepare our slides accordingly, so which would suit you more appropriately.
If anybody has any other queries, you can directly mail to our speakers. On behalf of Hiragangi and Associates LLP and the participants, I would like to express my gratitude to our speakers for accepting our request to handle the webinar today. I would also like to thank the participants for their active participation in this endeavor to serve you all. With that, I would like to end today's session by wishing you all a very good evening. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Sushil. Thank you, Anushree.
Thank you. Thank you.